I want to give a little bit of background on Zika and sort of how we approach it from a vaccine development standpoint. And then I'm going to go through some of the candidate Zika vaccines that have been put into clinical trial. We do have some good news, we have some bad news, and then I'll end with some of the hurdles that we're encountering with Zika vaccine development. So after the WHO declared Zika a public health emergency of international concern, there were numerous vaccine developers and manufacturers who really stepped up and said, we are committed to making a Zika vaccine for use for the prevention of Zika, and particularly early on, targeting women of childbearing age and pregnant women to prevent the serious outcome of congenital Zika syndrome. One of the, I would say, positives to Zika is that it appears that there's a single serotype, meaning that vaccine development should be at least easier than dengue, where there's four different serotypes, and certainly maybe a little bit easy to make. One of the complications was, though, that, you know, how much protection do we need? So as was presented earlier by Patricia, Zika congenital syndrome has been observed in babies born to mothers who were infected in any trimester, first, second, or third trimester. I will say very early on in the Zika vaccine development, the thought was that most of the infections occur in the first trimester, therefore it really wouldn't be practical to try to develop a vaccine that could be given to pregnant women because they would already have been infected by the time the vaccine-induced immunity. As time went on, that thought changed as we recognized that women were being infected in any trimester, and that could lead to congenital Zika syndrome. Then we had the problem of what's the ultimate target population. If you're looking in an outbreak setting, then of course the population you want to protect are pregnant women. So do you target only pregnant women for vaccination? That's problematic because generally they're at least well into their first trimester before they know that they're pregnant, and they could have been infected before then. Do you target only women of childbearing potential? What vaccine do you develop? Because there's different safety risks depending upon the type of vaccine, if it's targeted for pregnant women or non-pregnant women. And then knowing that it can also be sexually transmitted, do you target men as part of that target population? How do you prioritize if you have a limited amount of vaccine? Which group are you really going to target for vaccination? And then the other complication was Guillain-Barré syndrome, or what I'll call Guillain-Barré-like syndrome, because there's been a lot of different neurological manifestations that don't necessarily all fit under the umbrella of Guillain-Barré syndrome. And part of the complication is we don't really know whether that's an effect of a direct viral effect or whether that's an immune-mediated phenomenon, as is thought with Guillain-Barré, for instance, due to influenza and influenza vaccine. If it is an immune-mediated phenomenon, then perhaps there's the same risk with vaccination if it's inducing a protective immune response. So I said that many groups stepped up. I'm just going to go through and show you. These are all of the candidate vaccines that were listed with WHO as being developed or planning to be developed for Zika. And you can see that there were a lot. There were more than 40 candidate vaccines that were initially listed as being developed for the prevention of Zika. There have been only a few of those candidate vaccines that have actually entered clinical trial, and I'm going to talk to you really about two candidate vaccines, and these are the two that have progressed the furthest in clinical trial and that we actually have published data on safety and immunogenicity. The first is a DNA vaccine that was developed by the Vaccine Research Center at the U.S. National Institutes of Health. And I will say one of the great advantages of DNA vaccines is that they can be designed, developed, manufactured, and put into clinical trial very, very quickly. So the VRC was able to design this vaccine and put it initially, you know, have a GMP-made lot into clinical trial very, very quickly, I think within 6 months, 6 to 9 months of the declaration. They had a strategy that they based on their DNA vaccine for West Nile virus. This virus was demonstrated to be safe and immunogenic in both younger and older populations, so they felt that it was a good design. It's a plasmid that contains the pre-M and E proteins of Zika. We think, like other flaviviruses, that it's the E protein that is the the antigen that produces or induces neutralizing and protective antibody. And they started a phase one clinical trial with two different constructs. I'm not going to go into great detail on the two constructs, only to say that one had some sequence of JE virus that they thought would make more protein produced by the vaccine and perhaps make the vaccine more immunogenic. They tested doses of 1 milligram and 4 milligrams. These were two doses given 4 weeks apart, either a 1 milligram dose given 4 weeks apart or a 4 milligram dose given 4 weeks apart. And they compared this with a single dose and with placebo. They also included a non-human primate. In their non-human primate study, they included challenge. And what they found is that 17 of the 18 animals that received two doses were protected. I put this slide up to show that one of the things that they really looked at is to see, can we determine a correlate of protection or a correlate of immunity? Do we have a threshold of neutralizing antibody that we think will be protective? And one of the big questions that we had early on in vaccine development for Zika is how much protection is needed. Do we just want to protect against clinical disease, or do we need to actually protect against infection, which is a very, very high bar for a vaccine? And the reason for that is, as Patricia described earlier, asymptomatic mothers can give birth to babies with congenital Zika syndrome. Does that mean that those mothers had only very low levels of circulating virus? We don't really know. But the concern was that congenital Zika syndrome may not be related to peak amount of Zika virus circulating. So that even if a very small amount of Zika were circulating, and that could result in clinical Zika syndrome, do we need to actually prevent infection? And that, I think, still is to some degree a question that is out there for vaccine development. As I said, it's an incredibly high bar. And also comes into the question of what is going to be your outcome of your efficacy studies, which I'll talk about at the very end. But what was shown by Ted Pearson's group when they analyzed the neutralizing antibody from the non-human primate study, if you look over here, is that they were able to determine in their virus replicating particle assay that they needed a titer of about 1 to 1,000 to show protection. So if you look down here, all of these animals were protected, these animals were not, and they went back and calculated, I'm sorry, the red animals, I think, were not protected, the blue animals were, but they found that if you had a titer of about 1 to 1,000, then most of the animals were protected. They took these data, and they took both constructs into phase one clinical trial. They looked at, as I said, two different vaccines. They looked at many different doses. They looked at different dosing regimens for this, looking at IM versus ID and different, giving some in one arm and some in another arm, looking at many, many different combinations to try to determine which combination, which vaccine number one would be most immunogenic, how many doses do we need to give, and then what's the best route of delivery. And again, this is important if you're thinking long-term or thinking prospectively about how are we going to deliver this vaccine. If we need to give three doses of vaccine to induce immunity, then that makes it difficult to vaccinate pregnant women because that time would be quite a long time to develop immunity. This is a kind of busy slide, and I don't really want to go into great detail. What I will say is that one of the constructs, the construct that included some sequences of JE virus, did not perform as well as the other construct. And that was a bit of a surprise, but it has been very helpful for vaccine design because Ted Pearson, who is at NIH and working with the folks at the BRC, has gone back and realized that, you know, little tweaks that you make to these constructs when you're expressing proteins and wanting them to assemble into virus-like particles, which is what this vaccine does, those sequences can make a difference in viral assembly and how those different epitopes are presented, and that actually the construct that had the JE sequence did not present epitopes as well as the other construct. And this is the construct in BRC-320 that was elected to move forward into phase 2B clinical trial based on this group here, which showed, if you look at first vaccination, second vaccination, third vaccination, how many people were responders. And you see that you have a pretty good response after first dose, better response up to 100% after second dose. And you see very little increase in antibody titer, even from the second to the third dose. And what that tells you is that perhaps you only need two doses of this construct, which was important moving forward in terms of what they're going to test. So this is the construct that's moved forward. It is currently in a phase 2B efficacy study in these different sites, mostly in Latin America, some sites in the U.S. This was an adaptive design clinical trial, meaning that they started with a sample size, I believe, around 2,000, with the option to expand that if Zika circulation decreased, with the hopes that they would be able to identify enough cases within their clinical trials to look at efficacy. They also had in their adaptive design looking at different sites, thinking that with modeling they may be able to predict where Zika might appear, and they could move their clinical trial site should that prove to be necessary. Unfortunately, with the rapid decline in circulation of Zika, right now it doesn't appear that an efficacy endpoint will be met. I will say that Barney Graham, who's leading this effort at the Vaccine Research Center, is still somewhat optimistic that they may be able to get some efficacy data. But it's very unclear at this point whether they're going to be able to see any efficacy data in this study because of the very low circulation of Zika at this time in Latin America. I'm going to move on to the second vaccine that has been extensively evaluated in phase 1 clinical trial, and this is an inactivated Zika vaccine. It's a purified inactivated virus that was developed from the Puerto Rican strain of Zika. It's, I would say, classic vaccine development, old school vaccine development, in that it's formalin inactivated vaccine. It's administered with alum as an adjuvant, and it's given by the intramuscular route. What they found is that when they tried to give it by the sub-Q route, it did not protect 100% of the mice, and so they elected to move forward with the intramuscular route. And again, because they had low-level viremia in those who were not protected, they also tried to look and see, can we determine what level of antibody is necessary to actually prevent infection? This is a group effort. There were investigators at RARE, there were investigators at Beth Israel, and then Sanofi also joined in on the effort with this vaccine, and investigators at St. Louis University who did the first phase 1 study of this vaccine. It was a complicated design, and I won't go through all of it because each site was doing a little bit something different, trying to answer different questions. For instance, RARE was looking at previous vaccination with yellow fever virus to see if that would help. SLU and Beth Israel were looking at different doses. Some of these individuals were screened for previous flavivirus infection by antibody. Others were screened only by history. So each of the sites did things a little bit differently. SLU was evaluating these different doses given 4 weeks apart. Beth Israel was looking at two doses, either 5 milligrams given 4 weeks apart, or 5 milligrams given 2 weeks apart, or a single dose. And when we look at this is the neutralizing antibody response. This is done by another assay, and I will say in the flavivirus field, this is a big issue that we have. Everybody does their assays a little bit differently. So the only thing that I want to say by that is you can't really compare the antibody titers that you see in this study with the antibody titers that I showed you previously. They're done using different assays. The other point that I want to make is Beth Israel, as I said, screened people for previous flavivirus infection by history only. They later retrospectively went back and tested their samples prior to the samples that were collected prior to vaccination, and did find a few that actually did have flavivirus antibodies prior to vaccination. What we see from this is it appears that the group at Beth Israel had, I would say, what would be considered the best response in terms of neutralizing antibody titer. Again, if you look, it required two doses, so this is the peak response. After two doses, I sort of normalized this to two doses. Overall, what you see is a fairly good neutralizing antibody response. What they found is that with those who had data available, 92% seroconverted after two doses if you used a titer of greater than 1 to 10 to seroconvert. Now, I said earlier that the Vaccine Research Center identified a titer of 1 to 1,000 is what they thought would prevent infection. This group, using their assay and the mice data, found a titer of 1 to 100 to be what they felt was needed to prevent infection. And so if you look at, we go from 92% down to 77% who had a titer greater than or equal to 1 to 100 after two doses. And again, this comes into the problem that you have. Do we need to prevent infection? Do we only need to prevent symptomatic illness? Would this be good enough? Would this number be good enough? And really, we just don't know. We have no way to know without an efficacy study. So again, if you looked at this, it appears as though two doses of the purified inactivated vaccine were able to induce neutralizing antibody titers at a titer of greater than 1 to 100 in 77% of vaccinated individuals. The advantage to this is that you can give those two doses 4 weeks apart, so you have an accelerated vaccination schedule, which would be useful if you are in either doing an outbreak setting or intending to vaccinate pregnant women. The purified inactivated vaccine platform has been studied in pregnant women and is felt to be safe for pregnant women. I will say that the DNA vaccine, we have no DNA vaccines that have been studied in pregnant women. So we have no data, and whether or not that would be acceptable from a regulatory perspective, at this point we don't know. That would be something that would have to be tested in pregnant women. They found if they passively transferred antibody at a titer of greater than 100, greater than or equal to 1 to 100, it was able to protect mice from challenge. And that's, again, where they get this greater than 1 to 100 titer that may be necessary to actually prevent infection. They had originally planned to evaluate a third dose of vaccine. They did get relatively good data from two doses. As I said, 77% developed a titer that they felt would be protective. Unfortunately, the program right now is on hold, I think, for a couple reasons. These are, again, when I discuss the hurdles of vaccine development, this is one of them. There does not, at this period of time, appear to be a good way to evaluate efficacy of these vaccines if we're looking at traditional phase three efficacy studies. Why is that? Well, this is data from the CDC. If we look at the total number of cases of Zika cases from January 2015 through January 2017, we had about 5,600 cases. If we now look at what happened up into 2017, 378 cases of, and this is just U.S. data, so these are just travel-associated cases, but we see a remarkable decline in the circulation of Zika and the incidence of Zika, which makes doing a traditional phase three efficacy study nearly impossible. It's the same problem that we have, for instance, with chikungunya. And this is just also another illustration. If we're looking at Zika over time in Brazil, we see that we're out here with very, very few cases of Zika. This was a study, I thought this was interesting. It's modeling exercise that Neil Ferguson did, trying to predict, helping to predict these vaccine developers, help them predict where and when to do efficacy studies for their vaccines. And what he has predicted is that the duration of the current outbreak, current at that time being 2016, would last about 3 years. And he is predicting future outbreaks about every 10 years with the thought that you need to replenish a susceptible population. So as Zika goes through Latin America, for instance, and infects a large proportion of the population, it's going to take several years, several birth cohorts to replenish that naive population. And again, that's going to make it very difficult as we try to do efficacy studies for any candidate vaccines that we have. So we heard a little bit about Thailand. Asia's not yet reported large outbreaks, but we know that there's ongoing circulation, trying to predict where there's enough circulation to actually do a phase three efficacy study, we just can't do. This is our major problem right now, or our major hurdle for Zika vaccine development, is currently we do not have the traditional pathway toward licensure open to us. There simply is not enough circulation of Zika to do this traditional phase three efficacy study. Hopefully, we're going to get some data from the phase 2b study of the DNA vaccine. When that data is going to be available, I'm not exactly sure. The trial has been enrolling. There are no data reported now as to how many cases of Zika they have in the trial, but I personally am not optimistic that they're going to have enough cases to look at efficacy. Barney is a little bit more optimistic, so he can give a different story, but I really think it's going to be difficult to really see efficacy given the circulation of Zika that we have. So what is the regulatory pathway forward? What do we do? We know that a Zika vaccine could be incredibly important and effective in preventing Zika and preventing Zika congenital syndrome if we had a safe and effective vaccine. So there was a technical consultation on immune correlates of Zika that was held at the NIH in March of this year. WHO, NIH, and FDA all attended. The FDA expressed openness to the use of a Zika-controlled human infection model as a pathway to licensure if traditional phase three efficacy studies could not be done. Other considerations that were discussed were using the animal rule or using perhaps a known correlate of protection as a bridge to licensure. The animal rule was less acceptable. So what do we know about Zika-controlled human infection models? So I, along with collaborators at the NIH, first proposed in mid-2016 to use a controlled human infection model for Zika to downselect the more than 40 candidates that had been proposed at the time. We also felt that a model could be extremely useful to learn more about Zika, particularly shedding of Zika in bodily fluids, sexual transmission of Zika, and other questions that we had in terms of viral load and shedding and peak viral load and symptoms and other sort of questions about Zika that we just did not have any data on. There was an ethics consultation held in December of 2016. I will say I was not happy with the consultation, and I'll go through some of it in a minute. But I think one of the key problems with this was that the consultation was put together in a very short period of time, and unfortunately, I don't think we had the right experts there to really go through some of the key issues. So data at that time were not presented on sexual transmission in terms of how many cases of sexual transmission were reported at the time, when did sexual transmission occur in respect to return from Zika endemic areas, how was it associated with symptoms, that sort of thing. Data were not presented on prospective studies of GBS, so we had no data presented on what we think the actual risk of GBS is with Zika. I still think that's a big question that we don't really know. There aren't enough data, on GBS. What's the risk of GBS compared with background risk and also other flaviviruses like dengue? And I think the biggest problem was that the committee was not experienced in the use of controlled human infection models related to vaccine or other studies. So they just did not have the familiarity or the knowledge to really assess how a controlled human infection model was used. The result, I will say the other issue that I think was important is that they did not review the protocol or ask about the planned human infection model to see how some of the risks of a controlled human infection model would be addressed. This was their report. It's still on this website here. You're free to read the entire report. What they concluded, this came out, I think, in January or February of 2017. is that there was substantial uncertainty about the risks of a CHIM. They were particularly concerned about the risk to third parties, and that means sexual transmission as well as congenital Zika syndrome. They felt that there was not a strong argument that a challenge study would accelerate vaccine development. I will say if you look at other vaccines and CHIMs that are used for vaccine development, there is very strong evidence that controlled human infection models can, in fact, accelerate vaccine development. And the malaria controlled human infection model is now a requisite part of evaluating different malaria vaccines. They had, at that time, they felt there was an absence of an indication that field trials will be prohibitively difficult to conduct. I would say that that certainly has changed. And so at that point, they concluded that the time was not right to proceed with a Zika-controlled human infection model. So what has changed? I would say that there's been a significant change since January, February 2017, just in the past year. It's clear that the epidemic has waned and that traditional phase three efficacy studies will not be possible, particularly for multiple candidates. There are now substantial data on the clinical course of Zika infection in humans. I think we've gained some data. I think there's a lot more information that we can still get, particularly from controlled human infection model. Third-party protections can be put in place and certainly are put in place for every CHIM that we do, and this includes housing people as inpatients to prevent both mosquito transmission and sexual transmission. And of course, a robust and thorough informed consent process. I think that the Zika CHIM can still provide a lot of data on shedding a virus and its relation to symptoms. I think one of the key missing points that we've had throughout the Zika outbreak and the studies that have been done is that there are very few groups that actually do virology, where you look for infectious virus. So most of the virus in all of the studies that are presented, it's detected by PCR, and PCR does not tell you whether or not that virus is infectious. It only tells you that there's pieces of the virus that may be being shed. It does not tell you whether that is live replicating virus or infectious virus. What we do know is that recent data demonstrate a very low frequency of shedding of infectious virus. This is a paper that came out in April by Mead et al. From CDC, where they looked for infectious virus in men who had shed semen that contained PCR, virus by PCR. So overall, they had 60 of 186 men, 33%, had semen that was positive by PCR. But when they looked at timing of this, and I think this is really important, the timing is very important. So if you collected the semen before 30 days, there was a much higher incidence of shedding by PCR than after 30 days. So 61% of the samples that were collected between 2 weeks and 30 days were positive by PCR. They then looked at how many of those samples overall were positive for infectious virus. So they tested 78 samples that were positive by RT-PCR. Only three samples, 4%, contained infectious virus. That's these three up here. And what you could see is that all of those samples were collected within 30 days of symptom onset, and all of those samples that were positive by culture had some of the highest titers by RT-PCR. So what that seems to show is that you need a very high titer of virus in semen in order to recover infectious replicating virus, and that appears to occur early post-return, so within a month post-return. So the only time they were able to recover infectious virus by culture was if the RT-PCR titer was 7 logs or higher. And what's interesting, if you go back then and look at the epidemiological data for sexual transmission, it really corresponds well to that. So all but one case of sexual transmission occurred within 21 days after illness onset in the source male patient. There was one case of reported sexual transmission that occurred at day 41. However, both people had traveled to the endemic area. When they looked infectious, referring to the MEAD study, this corresponds to their data where infectious virus was detected only within 30 days of symptom onset. And infectious virus was detected only at high loads. So again, it appears that your highest risk is early post-return or post-development of symptoms, certainly within 2 weeks to 30 days. They also found that men who were older and ejaculated less frequently were more likely to have prolonged shedding, and those who were younger and ejaculated more frequently were less likely to have shedding. So the thought was, you know, that you're flushing the virus out, that this is an ongoing replication of virus within the male, that there appears to be virus by RT-PCR that can, in essence, be flushed out with more frequent ejaculation. What these studies tell us, though, is that we may be able to identify subjects who are at higher risk for transmitting Zika sexually. If you're looking at viral load and determining a viral load of greater than or equal to 7 logs, then that person would be at risk for sexual transmission. So I think the conclusions are that at this point in time, vaccine development is sort of in a holding pattern. We're awaiting the results of the phase 2B study that the Vaccine Research Center at the NIH is doing to see if any efficacy results will be available. Certainly we'll have a large data set from that vaccine, which will be helpful. There's also an RNA vaccine that is in phase 1 clinical trial. I didn't include results from that clinical trial because they haven't been published yet. They are also undergoing a reformulation of that vaccine based on some of their early animal data. I think most other developers are really waiting to see if Zika is going to reemerge. Most of the programs are clinically on hold. They don't see a regulatory pathway forward at this time, and also looking at what the demand for a Zika vaccine will be. If Zika does not reemerge, then the feeling is that there's not going to be a great demand. However, again, as a vaccine developer, feeling is that you want to be able to vaccinate people to prevent reemergence of disease. But I think right now, again, most of the programs are currently on hold. We'll see. If right now there's not a clear pathway forward, we're going to revisit the controlled human infection model and see if that may be helpful in terms of getting some efficacy data. I will also say that my colleagues at the NIH have developed a live attenuated chimeric Zika dengue vaccine, which will enter clinical trial at the end of July. The thought of that vaccine development program, clinical development program, is to include controlled human infection model as a test for efficacy if that is acceptable to FDA. But that, again, is for the future. It has not been, the CHIM has not been submitted to FDA yet for review. And that's all I have.